Good afternoon and welcome to our midday Bible study. I'm Reverend Janice Mitchell, First Community Antioch. I would like to thank our pastor, Dr. Stephen Beckham, for this opportunity that he's allowed me to do our Bible study on today. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious and everlasting Father, Father, we come right now just to say thank you. Oh God, we thank you for your loving kindness. We thank you for your tender mercies. Oh, God, realizing that if it had not been for you on our side, oh, God, where would we be on today? Oh, God, we come right now to give your name glory, to give your name honor, and to give your name praises. Oh, God, we thank you, dear God, for all that you've done, all that you're doing, and, oh, God, all that you will do. Oh, God, remind us on today, God, that we can do nothing without you. But God, you said in your word that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. Now, God, we come lifting up bereaved families all over, God, those that are sick and shut in, God. Oh, God, you know them name by name. Father, we pray right now that you will just bless and comfort them in whatever they're going through, God. Now, God, as we get into our Bible study on today, God, we pray right now that you would help us not only to be hearers of your word, God, but help us to be doers. And God, when this Bible study is over, let us not be the same, God. Change our hearts, God. Change our minds, God, so we can do those things that bring glory and honor to you. God, we ask this right now in your name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Again, we want to thank our pastor for this opportunity he's given us. I'm going to move on to our scripture today. Our scripture will be coming from Paul's letter to the Galatians, chapter 5, beginning at verse 22, and it reads, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such, there is no law." King James calls it faith. I'll be reading from the New King James Version, and it calls it faithfulness. Now, we've heard about the fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, and peace. These can be seen as qualities given by God. Long-suffering, kindness, and goodness can be seen as qualities that enable relationships pleasing to God. Faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control can be seen as qualities that enable us abiding with God. So my assignment today is to talk about the seventh fruit, which is faithfulness. So I'm going to title this Bible study lesson today, Faithfulness is a Choice. You make the call. Faithfulness is a choice. You make the call. Now, Paul has put these fruit in of the Spirit in the Bible for us to live by. And all scripture this afternoon will be coming from the New King James Version. So get your paper and your pencils out because this is Bible study. Hebrews 11 and 1. Let's start with faith. Faith is now the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So we know faith is belief, assurance of God's word, and all that he has done. So today we're going to talk about faith, faithful, and faithfulness. When we have faith, and the Bible says the size of a mustard seed, we know that we can move mountains. When we have faith, then it's a process of becoming faithful, and faithfulness is living in accordance with that truth. In other words, faith leads to faithful, and faithful leads to faithfulness. And when we look at the word faithfulness, let's see what faithfulness means. Faithfulness is the quality of being faithful, trustworthy, loyal, reliable, and dependable. And those of us who produce these fruits, we can be counted as dependable, loyal, trustworthy, and reliable. Let us look at our first point on this afternoon. God's faithfulness toward us. God's faithfulness toward us. Lamentations 3, verses 22 and 23, it says, through the Lord's mercy, we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Saints of God, every morning when we wake up, brand new mercies is facing us. And you know, as I was preparing this lesson, when I was assigned faithfulness, you know, God just showed me, he said, I'm faithful. 1 Corinthians 1 and 9 says, God is faithful. So time after time, from Genesis to Revelation, we can see the faithfulness of God. Not just this morning. Every morning, we don't have to worry about what we did yesterday, last night, but when we woke up this morning, new mercies was there facing us. You know, how many times God has not been faithful to us? God never fails. His faithfulness is renewed every morning. The Holy Spirit produces this fruit. Those of us who are led by the Holy Spirit, we're going to produce the fruit of faithfulness in our lives. Nobody can manufacture it. Only God can produce faithfulness. Acts 17 and 28 say, for in him we live, we move, and we have our beings. We can't do nothing without him. Paul reminds us that in Philippians 4 and 13. He said, what? I can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. So we have to submit to his word and our actions to his will, not our own will, but to his will, in order to bring about the manifestation of faithfulness. He's waiting on us to submit. Now, these fruits of the Spirit are not just in the Bible just for us to read. God wants us to live by these fruits. He's waiting on us. Let me tell you on this afternoon, faithfulness starts with being obedient and submissive. It's not a common fruit. You don't hear a lot about faithfulness. But faithfulness starts with being obedient and submissive. The faithfulness of God means God is unchanging in his nature. He doesn't change. We change, but he doesn't change. He's true to his word. God has promised salvation to his people, and God will keep his promises forever. Many times we promise people things and we change, but I'd serve notice today, God never changes. He is that faithful. He has been, he is, and he will always be compassionate and unchanging. Nobody can give us that fruit called faithfulness. God fertilizes us, and he prunes us, and he develops us through faith and being faithful, and then faithfulness will show. It's the working of the Holy Spirit in our lives that produces faithfulness. You can't buy faithfulness, and it can't be manufactured. You can't fake it. That's one thing, you cannot fake it. If you're faithful, it's going to show, and people will know that you're faithful. Only God can transform the heart of man. You know, David said in Psalms, he said, Lord, create me a clean heart. But I want to let us know this morning, that this afternoon, that only God can transform the heart. Verse 21 talks in Galatians talks about the flesh. The flesh cannot produce this spiritual fruit. Just as the work of the flesh is shown, the fruit of the Spirit going to be shown also. Zechariah 4 and 6 said, not by might nor by power, but he said, by my Spirit. How many know on today God for God to be a way maker? He's just that faithful. That's the faithfulness of God. How many times God has made a way for you that are watching on today? Not only one way, he keeps blessing us, what, over and over and over again, multiple times, he keeps blessing us. Also, he's our promise keeper. God always keeps his promise. When we don't, he always does. Hebrews 10 and 23 say, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is faithful. For he who promised is faithful. I'm talking about, it's a choice that we have to make. Faithfulness is a choice. It's up to us now. You make the call whether you want to be faithful. Also, he's our light in a darkness. 1 John 1 and 5 said, this is the message that we have heard from him and declare to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. How many know today he loves us with an everlasting love? That's the faithfulness of God. New mercies he give us every day. God loves us and his love never fails for us. My next point is, we see that God is faithful. Now, some might be asking or saying, I want to grow in my faithfulness. I just feel like I want to grow. Let's look at our second point, growing in our faithfulness to God. John tells us in John 15 and 4, he said, abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine. Neither can you unless you abide in me. Now we know Hebrews 11 and 6 say what? Without faith, it's impossible to please God. So if you want to grow in your faithfulness to God, we got to, first of all, have a personal relationship with God. We got to stay connected to the vine. We have to make him real. We have to trust him. Faith doesn't make sense, but we have to trust God. If we want to grow in our faithfulness to God, let's look at Psalms 1. Faithfulness is a choice, but you have to make the call. I'm going to read this from the New Living Translation. It says, oh, the joys of those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or stand around with sinners, or join in with mockers, but they delight in the law of the Lord, meditating day and night. They are like trees planted along the riverbank, bearing fruit in its season. Their leaves never wither, and they prosper in all they do. But the wicked, they are like worthless chaff, scattered by the wind. They will be condemned at the time of judgment. Sinners will have no place among the godly. For the Lord watches over the path of the godly, but the path of the wicked leads to destruction. It's less about what we're doing, but it's more about why we're doing it, how we're doing it, and who are we doing it for. It should all be done to the glory of God if you want to be faithful. It's not about us. Growing into faithfulness is a process. You know, we are growing into faithfulness every day. It's called sanctification. It's pulling off more of the world and putting on more Christ. Every day, we should be striving to be more and more like Christ. Now, these fruits, like I said earlier, it's for us to live by. No, it won't happen overnight. But every day, we should be pulling off more of the world and putting on more of Christ if we want to be faithful. And how do we do that? First of all, we got to spend more quality time with God. We got to pray. We got to stay in His Word. We got to meditate. And you know, sometimes we got to get rid of some things. In order for us to grow into faithfulness, sometimes, saints of God, we just got to get rid of some things. Sometimes we just got to whoop, cut some people off. And you know what? God will develop His faithfulness in us. You know, a while back I asked Deacon Boudreaux, I said, what are sucker shoots? I was doing some reading one time, and he said, Reverend Janice, he said, sucker shoots are those things that grow on plants, and it hinders their growth. So sometimes, you know, we got to cut off those sucker shoots. Sometimes God has to prune us so that we can grow. You know, it takes more praying. We have to listen, and we have to be obedient. We have to even be submissive. People don't want to hear the word submissive, but if we want to be faithful to God, we got to be obedient, saints of God. We got to be submissive. We got to be supportive. We got to submit to authority. We got to be committed to the vision. You know, I was at Black Church Conference, and I was in a leadership class. And after class, I went on and I told the instructor, I said, you must have been in our study because, you know, I'm studying on faithfulness. He said, sister, he said, you have to be submissive. He said, and you got to support the vision. You got to support the vision. Now, faithfulness is a charge. You make the call whether you want to be faithful or not. But God is expecting each one of us to be faithful. What kind of fruit are you producing? We need to understand that as saints of God, we're on display. God got us on display. When you are controlled by the Holy Spirit, we don't have a problem displaying these fruits. Not one of them, but all of them. Love, joy, peace, kindness, long-suffering, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. We won't have a problem when we're being controlled by the Holy Spirit. When we are faithful, we are motivated to love, and not just love, but love unconditional. That's the first fruit. Minister Corey talked about that. God has put on the cluster of the fruit of the Spirit. 1 Corinthians 13:4-8 say, love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. It's not puffed up. Love does not behave rudely, does not seek its own. Love is not provoked. It thinks no evil, does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in truth. It goes on to say, it bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. What we're saying, what we're doing, what about our actions? By their fruits, we will know them. The word of God says in Matthew 7:16-20, it says, you will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Even so, every good fruit bears good fruit. But a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown in a fire. Therefore, it's talking about everything before that. Therefore, by their fruits, you will know them. You will know them. In our lives, every word and every action is fruit from our hearts. Sinners sin because that's what's in their heart. Thieves steal because that's what's in their heart. Bad hearts bear bad fruit. In order for us to grow in our faithfulness, we have to be good stewards of God's gifts to us. Everything that we have and everything comes from God and it belongs to God. We don't own anything in life. The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. Another thing, we have to examine our commitments in light of God's word. We know what he has called us to do, but are we faithful in what we're doing? Every now and then, we got to do what's called a self-examination. You know, about 3 weeks ago, you know, it's close to hurricane season, and I went to see my insurance lady about my insurance that I have. You know, every now and then, we got to go back. And you know, Pastor always say, every now and then, we got to go back, what? Down memory lane. And review our insurance to see what we have. We have to check ourselves to see if we're really producing the fruit that God has put there for us. What he has called us to do. Are we going out there and witness? Are we telling somebody about Christ? Are we praying? Are we faithful to prayer meeting? Are we faithful to Bible study? Are we faithful to discipleship? It's a choice. You make the call. Let us look at the parable of the talents. Beginning at Matthew 25 and 14. It says, for the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling to a far country who called his own servants and delivered his goods to them. And one he gave 5 talents, to another 2 talents, and to another 1, to each according to his ability. And immediately he went on a journey. Then he who had received the 5 talents, he went and he traded them and made another 5 talents. And likewise, he who had received 2 gained 2 more also. But he who had received 1 went and dug in the ground and hid his Lord's mercy. And after a long time, the Lord's servants came and settled accounts with them. So he had received 5 talents, came and brought what? 5 other talents. Say, Lord, you delivered me 5 talents. Look, I have gained 5 more talents besides them. And his Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You are faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. He also who had 2 talents came and said, Lord, you delivered to me 2 talents. Look, I have gained 2 more talents besides them. And his Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many. Enter into the joy of your Lord. Then he who had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you have not sown and gathered where you have not scattered seed. And I was afraid and went and hid your talent in the ground. Look, there you have what is yours. But his Lord answered and said to him, you wicked and lazy servant, you knew that I reap where I had not sown and gathered where I had not scattered seed. So you ought to have deposited my money with the bankers, and at my coming, I would have received back my with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one who has 10 talents. For to everyone, I want us to get this, for to everyone, more will be given, and he will have abundance, but from him who does not have, even when he has, will be taken away. And cast the unprofitable servant into outer darkness, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Now I want to ask a question on today. Are we being faithful to what God has called us to do? Is there anybody out there listening want to hear God say, well done, thy good and faithful servant? I don't want to just hear him say, well done, good. I want to hear God say, well done, thy good and faithful servant. You know, somebody might be asking, well, I've heard, you know, that God is faithful. And I've heard now how I can grow into my faithfulness. My next point is, how do I demonstrate the fruit called faithfulness? How do I demonstrate this fruit called faithfulness? Let's look at Mark chapter 10, verse 45. It says, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. If you want to be faithful, you got to learn how to serve. We all servants. Many times we forget about that, but every now and then we got to realize that we all are servants. These fruits can be shown in and through our life when we continually grow. When we are faithful, God will put us in a place to be used by him. I'm going to say that again. When we are faithful, God going to put us in a place to be used by him. Being faithful means we're being dependable, we're loyal, we're trustworthy. Now, I'm going to ask a question. Can we be trusted? Are we faithful? Like I said earlier, it's not a common fruit. Colossians 3, 23 and 24, Paul tells us, whatever you do, do it heartily, as to the Lord and not to men. We got to remember, only what we do for Christ will last. We don't have to do it for no show. God sets up high and he knows what we are doing and he knows who we are doing it for. He said, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance, for you serve the Lord Christ. We are not just serving men on earth, but we are serving God, and we should put forth our best efforts in all we do. And like I said earlier, all we do should be done for the glory of God. It's not about us. Proverbs 28 and 20 say, a faithful person will be richly blessed. Now, if you want to be blessed, we got to learn how to serve. We got to demonstrate faithfulness. We all are servants, but what does it mean to be a faithful servant? Okay, being faithful is putting our faith into action. Putting our faith into action. God is looking for fat people. He's looking for fat Christians. I don't mean in size. Because if you talk to everybody, oh, I'm too fat. I want to lose some weight. I want to do this. God is looking for people that's faithful, available, and teachable. Now, if you're available and teachable, you're still not faithful. And if you're teachable and available, you're still not faithful. God is looking for all three in us. He wants us to be faithful, available, and teachable. And every one of these fruits is ours for the taking. I don't know about you, but I want everything that God has for me. And you know, this Luke said in 17:5, the disciples asked Jesus to increase their faith. And saints of God, we can do the same thing. When we say we want to be the hands and the feet of Jesus, we have to remember what happened to his hands and feet. He went through some things, but he never gave up. Okay, I told us about faithfulness is not a common fruit. But we need to understand sometime being faithful, we're going to be rebuked. But we can't give up. We have to be persistent and confident in our walk with God. We have to ask God to keep us fixed and keep us focused. And it's okay. It's okay to ask God. He said in his word, whatever we ask in prayer, believing, we shall receive it. The enemy wants us to throw in a towel. But we got to know that we are more than conquerors. We already victory. We got the victory. You know, isn't it good to know on this afternoon that God doesn't renege on his promises to us? Especially when we honor God and we serve God. Folks going to look at you and wonder, man, they're just always so joyful. Because the joy of the Lord is our strength. I want to be faithful. I want to one day hear God say, well done, that good and faithful servant. Yes, I have problems, but I don't look at my problem. I look at my problem solver. He said, cast all our cares on him, our concerns, whatever it is. I want to stay faithful, but when I go through, I know who to go to. You know, Numbers 23 and 19 say, God is not a man that he should lie. How many of us have heard the saying, God said it, I believe it, and that settles it? You don't have to believe it. God said it, and that settles it, whether you believe it or not. When he said he will never leave us, he's always near us, he's just that faithful. God doesn't live in time. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. That's the faithfulness of God. He loves us with an everlasting love. So as Christians, it's so important for us to be faithful to God because he wants us to be faithful. It's one thing to believe in him, but it's another thing to be faithful to God. So many times we are faithful to this one, we are faithful to that one, but how many of us are faithful to God? A lot of us have faith, but who do we have faith in? Who do we have faith in? I know many people go home, they wash the soaps, they have to, you know, I got to wash my store. But are you that faithful to God? Like you are faithful to those soaps, like you are faithful to your friend. God's faithfulness toward us give us the strength to be faithful people. Like I said earlier, faithfulness is a choice. You make the call. Let us look at point number four. I'm almost out your way. Let's look at some examples of the faithful ones in the Word of God that made the right choice. Some faithful ones that made the right choice in the Bible. Let's look at Abraham, known as the father of the faithful. Genesis 12 through 22, Abraham obeyed God and he was faithful. You know, when God spoke to Abraham and told him to leave his country and he was going to a land that he knew nothing about, he didn't hesitate. He didn't hesitate, even when it came to a great cause of Abraham sacrificing his son, Isaac, on the altar. He was precious, but Abraham was faithful. And we all know the story that God provided a ram. And how many know on today? He's just that faithful. God will provide. And let's look at Job. Everybody said they want to be like Job. But Job kept his eyes on God, even in his suffering. And his wife saw all that he had gone through. He lost his children, he lost his cattle, he lost his money, all that Job went through. And his wife came and asked him, why don't you just curse God and die? And what he told her, he said, woman, you sound like a foolish woman. He never wavered in his faithfulness. He said, though he slay me, yet I will trust him. And Job never gave up on God. Okay, let's look at Ruth, sisters. Let's look at Ruth. There's many, many in the Bible that kept the faith. But let's look at Ruth. After her husband died, Ruth could have chosen to go off and do her own thing and start a new life for herself. But instead, what Ruth did, Ruth chose to become faithful with her mother-in-law, Naomi, and followed Naomi to her home country. She said, entreat me not to leave you or turn my back on you. She said, where you lodge, I will lodge. Where you go, I will go. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. Ruth remained faithful. And you know the rest of the story. It's a beautiful love story. Boaz came and found Ruth gleaning in the fields. Such a beautiful love story. Why? Because Ruth was faithful. Paul on a Damascus road. When Paul had his encounter with Jesus, he said, Lord, what would you have me to do? We know Paul wrote many books of the New Testament. Paul served faithful. Now, faithfulness is a choice. You make the call. Paul decided that he was going to stay with Jesus. In 2 Timothy 4, 6, and 8, he was talking to young Timothy. He said, I'm now ready. He was faithful to be offered up. He said, I fought a good fight. I finished my course. Paul was faithful until the end. And what about the most beautiful example of faithfulness in the Bible? Let's look at our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. They whipped him. They beat him. They said all kind of things about him. But he let nothing stop him. He went to the cross for you and for me. And on that cross, we know they whipped him. He even asked his father to forgive him, for they know not what they're doing. But he was faithful all the way to the end. He's worthy, y'all. He's dependable. My last point as I leave you all, what is he getting in return from us? What is he getting in return from us? Can we be counted as one that is faithful? Now, that's personal. Can you be counted as one that is faithful? Can Janice be counted? Can Mary be counted? Can Tyanika be counted as one that is faithful? You know, Paul said in 1 Timothy 1, 12 to 15, he said, and I thank my Christ Jesus, our Lord, who has enabled me because he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry. Although I was formerly a blasphemer, I was a persecutor and an insolent man, but I obtained mercy. Why? Because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. Paul is saying, he's confessing, and the grace of our Lord was exceedingly abundant with faith and love which are in Christ Jesus. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. So Paul admitted that he did all this. And we all fall sometime. But just know that when we fall, we can go our faith for God and confess to him. And what did he say? He said, he's saying 1 John 1 and 9, he said, if you confess your sins, he said, I'm faithful and just to forgive you. Not only that, he said, I'm going to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. So knowing today, first of all, we have to be more than just hearers of the word. If we want to be faithful, we got to be doers. He wants our faith put into action. He wants us to be faithful, available, and teachable. It's not about us, but it's all about him. It's not about my hands, but it's about my heart. What's in our heart? You know, sometimes God's going to test us. We heard a couple of weeks ago about tests and temptation. God doesn't tempt us, but he tests us. And sense of God, sometimes God will test us. Sometimes he will give us the character test. Are we going to pass it? Sometimes he will give us the heart test. Are you going to pass it? Sometimes he will even give us the submission test, the time test. Are we going to pass the test? We got to pass the test that God is putting before us. Can God trust us? All of us watching on today want the blessings of God, but do we want to be faithful to God? Are we faithful to our spouses, our families, our jobs? So many of us are faithful to our jobs, but when it's time to come to church, we're 10 minutes late, we're 20 minutes late, but not on that job. Not on that job. So I want to encourage someone on this afternoon. Paul said in Galatians 6 and 9, he said, let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season, not our season, and God knows when it's due season, he said, for in due season we will reap if we faint not and not lose heart. Don't grow tired of doing good. Doing good sometimes is hard work. Especially if when we're doing it and we don't see anything. But let us continue to do the works of the Lord. Sometimes it can be tough. But God wants us to continue and be faithful in doing good and to continue letting our light shine. In order to be faithful, sometimes we have to go that extra mile. Sometimes we have to give until it hurts. Sometimes we may have to go out of our way. And sometime we may have to make some sacrifices. Look at the sacrifice Jesus made for us. Sometime when we're faithful, we're going to have to do that. You may have to go down the road and pick this one up or pick that one up. But when we are faithful, God is going to reward us. We know he made the biggest sacrifice when he gave his son. And his son made the biggest sacrifice when he gave us his life. So as I close, faithfulness is a choice. Let us continue to be obedient and submissive. Let's display the fruits of faithfulness in our lives. I'm going to close with this song by Carrie Underwood. It says, great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, New mercies I see. I say that earlier. Every time we wake up in the morning, new mercies is facing us. We don't have to be concerned about the mercies yesterday. New morning, every morning by morning, new mercies I see. Waiting for us this morning. All I have needed, thy hand had provided. And when we look at all leaves nothing out. There's nothing on the other side of all. All I have needed, thy hand had provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Just as God is faithful to us, we should be faithful to him. Let us make the choice to be faithful to God. These fruits in the Spirit is for us to display each and every day. We don't want to display the works of the flesh. We want to display the works of the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit. May God bless you and may God keep you. This is my prayer.